In recent years, you may have heard of a relatively new computer architecture called the RISC-V. At little over a decade old, the RISC-V is a newcomer to the embedded ecosphere. So it's not too surprising that until recently, there weren't very many low-cost options for evaluating them in a hands-on fashion. Thanks to a few eval kits from SparkFun Electronics, that's no longer the case. So today, we're going to look at two platforms that are both made with the RISC-V in mind. This involves installing the programming environment, Freedom Studio, installing hardware drivers, building an example program, and finally flashing that program onto the physical hardware. This walkthrough focuses on Windows 10, however, I also set up the system for Linux in a previous article. Aside from that, you'll only need a web browser, an anti-malware tool, which is something I recommend anyway, and the rest will be installed later in the video. For hardware, this walkthrough uses the RED5 Redboard, or the RED5 Thing Plus board. You can use either one for this guide, since they both include the Kinetis K22F chip and the Freedom E310. The Freedom E310, or simply FE310, represents the RISC-V portion of both boards. RISC is short for Reduced Instruction Set Computer, and this instruction set architecture was started back in 2010 as part of UC Berkeley's Parallel Computing Laboratory. Since then, the system developed a large following due to its open-source, royalty-free approach. The core architecture is also modular, to the point that even smaller startups can successfully do iterative design. In total, all the advantages and trade-offs of this system are really outside the scope of this short video, so you can see the link in the description for more detail. The last piece of hardware that you're going to need, other than the platform itself, is a USB Type-A to Type-C cable. And with that out of the way, we can get started. Just like with any other installation, you should back up any data that you consider important, and also scan everything that you download from the internet with your favorite anti-malware tool. Like always, you'll probably want to install these things as administrator. Also, you'll need to modify your Windows registry in a later step. Changing the registry incorrectly can cause a lot of problems for Windows. Later on, I'll be showing how I modified my registry. But if you're uncertain about that step, or if your registry doesn't match what you see later on in the video, consider using the official guide instead. We'll start by visiting the official webpage. As of this writing, you can simply go to www.scifive.com, then navigate to Products, Boards and Software. Scroll down to the section that says Freedom Studio, and then select the operating system that matches your system. For today, the latest version is version 2020.06.3. The installation is about 1.3 gigabytes, so while you're waiting, scroll up a short distance and look for the Freedom Studio user manual. As a Windows user, the manual says we need to keep two things in mind. First, when we install Freedom Studio, we need to choose an installation directory that doesn't contain any spaces. That is, we also have to avoid the two program files directories. Secondly, we need to go to the Windows registry and make sure that Windows has LongPathsEnabled. To access, go to Windows Search and then type in regedit, R-E-G-E-D-I-T. Enter the following path into the navigation bar. You can also find a copy of this in the video description. And in the window that appears, you should see an option that says LongPathsEnabled. The type should be regdword. And we want the data value to be a 1. If it's already a 1, then you don't need to do anything. Back in the Downloads folder, scan Freedom Studio with your favorite malware tool, and then extract the zip file to the directory where you want it to go. Once everything is unzipped, run the executable freedomstudio.exe. Windows Security will probably prompt you for a confirmation, but it should run. If you can see the following welcome screen, then you can pause and then navigate to Windows File Explorer so that we can install the hardware drivers. Go to the same directory where freedomstudio.exe was located. From there, navigate to SciFive, then Drivers. Run the application called HiFive1Driver.exe, and then follow the on-screen instructions. This step will install the FTDI driver. After that's done, we need to install the JLink SEGGER drivers that will let the Kinetis K22 chip talk to our USB. Go back to that same directory that contains the freedomstudio.exe application, then navigate to SciFive, then JLink, then USB driver. The JLink directory will probably have a large string of numbers included with it. For my setup, my desktop uses an Intel 64 processor, so I went to the x64 folder, and then I ran the dpinst x64.exe application. If you have a different type of processor, then you should choose whatever matches best. Again, follow the on-screen instructions, and you should have the SEGGER JLink drivers installed. To double-check everything, you can also open Windows Device Manager, and Device Manager will mark any missing or misconfigured drivers with a yellow General Caution sign. Back in Freedom Studio, it's time to create that first project. Look for an option that says, I want to create a new Freedom eSDK project. According to SparkFun, the CiFive HiFive 1 Revision B board is compatible with the two boards you see here, so you're going to see this term come up often. In the Create a Freedom eSDK project window, first select CiFive HiFive 1 Rev B, then for the project name, select CiFive HiFive 1 Rev B Hello. This is an example program that will use the printf method to transmit a text message over the USB. Click Finish, and then Freedom Studio should start to automatically build the example program. When it's done, you should see the Edit Configuration window appear. For now, there's nothing to change, so just click Close. Doing that will bring you to the main development screen. Before we run the application, it's a good idea to create a while loop around the print method. This will cause the RISC-V to transmit the message constantly, and if we hadn't done this, we would probably need to reset the RED5 system just to make the message appear, and since we haven't tested everything yet, this could become cumbersome. Now that the while loop is in place, we can start to run configurations. There are basically two easy ways to do this. First, you can navigate to the far left side of the IDE, below the Project Explorer area, and then right-click your project name at the top of the tree, and then navigate to Run As, then Run Configurations. In the Run Configuration screen, look at the left side and look for the option that says CiFive GDB SEGGER JLink Debugging. Expand that option and you should see the project name CiFive HiFive 1 Rev B Hello. Make sure that part's selected and then click the Run button. Within moments, GDB, which is short for GNU Debugger, should be automatically configured and launched. And by now, the program should be well on its way to the RED5 board. If you encounter an error at this step, it's a strong indication that you probably have problems with the drivers. This is exactly what happened the first time I tried to install it, and you may need to restart Freedom Studio, restart your computer, or reinstall the drivers to make it work. If the process was successful, then the console area in the center of the Freedom Studio environment should generate a long report ending with the message starting target CPU. Finally, to actually see the text message, we'll need to open Freedom Studio's terminal. By default, mine was configured to use COM1, which displayed nothing, so to reconfigure it, I navigated to the lower right of the environment and clicked on the Terminal tab. At this point, it's probably worth opening Windows 10 Device Manager to see if we can figure out the correct COM port. Device Manager will group the RED5 board in the Ports, COM, and LPT category. In my case, there are two identical devices marked as JLink CDC UART port, with one occupying COM8 and the other occupying COM9. The correct one wound up being COM8, and I configured it for 115K baud, data size 8, no parity, one stop bit, and ISO 8859 encoding. Click OK, and your terminal should be prepared to receive the string. Click on the tab for your COM port, and if you still don't see anything, you can try to relaunch the application by first clicking the red stop button, followed by the green play button again. And that concludes the setup. The RISC-V architecture is very extensible, and among other things, there are variants covering the 32-bit, 64-bit, and 128-bit address spaces. That's a pretty long way to say that this has a lot of potential, and because of how easy it was to set this up, it's something you should expect to see a lot more of around here. On this blog, we cover electronics, robotics, IoT, and communication systems, so if you find this sort of thing useful, be sure to like and also share with other developers. We also have our Patreon page where we have a monthly poll and lessons learned on technical builds like this one. Our upcoming poll for August covers languages other than English, and if you'd like to see this translated into other languages, then we can certainly use your feedback. Stay posted for more RISC-V updates, and as always, have a great day.